You know what I mean? So that was the root, because we were just branches from a tree when we was out.
Yes.
From another root. We came together in prison with Islam and everything. We got rooted. We was in prison. That's how our brotherhood really came to collectively came together.
Well, good afternoon, everybody. My name is Fahim Al-Qadir, a.k.a. Lejon Reese. Here we are once again. After 100 years, we told everybody what we was about. We said we began, which is true, with no identity. Now we have identity now. And I just want to just pass the mic before we really get in tune with everything, what's going on. And to my right, we have...
It's Dante. Good afternoon. Back at you guys again.
And this is Patrick, Muslim name Hamza Shakur, better known as Cyrene American Dream, as they called me before. Yeah, glad to be here today, and can't wait to, you know, see how this play out.
Absolutely, absolutely. How everybody doing today on this Father's Day?
Oh man, it's a blessing, man.
It's a beautiful thing.
I couldn't, you know, man, it makes me smile. This is my first Father's Day in 30 years on the streets. And, you know, yesterday was celebrated. For me, it was yesterday.
Yes, sir.
Even though today was officially Father's Day for all fathers of America. But yesterday, it was beautiful, man. You know, y'all invited me to y'all own stomping grounds, man.
Yes, sir.
You know, and I got to meet y'all childhood homeboys. And I felt like, even though I wasn't there, I felt I was there, man. Yes, sir.
Well,
I really appreciate
that. You know, that's what family's about.
Right, right. So, you know, I had a great day, man. You know, it was just... You know, a lot of emotion was running, man.
Yes,
you know, got to see Dip, you know, a couple of good cats, man. And it was just, you know, taking us back to where, you know, where our humble beginning was.
Yes.
And I seen that on y'all faces, man. I didn't even see the graves. I seen y'all, man, like a little kid. I seen the little boy in y'all. When y'all was looking over the fence and all that, that was very touching to me,
yes,
man. You know, so I appreciate y'all inviting me, man, to where y'all stomach grounds. You know, it's like... I know I'm family to y'all, and it really feels good, man, you know. So, like I said, last podcast, I was on a high, you know. I'm still on a high. It's been a little bit over 2 months, so, you know, I'm good.
Beautiful thing. It's a beautiful thing. I appreciate everyone who's listening, all the positive reviews that we got back, those who said we could have done something a little more different, but most of all, everything was on point, and we appreciate it.
To be out here on Father's Day, we got together yesterday, you know, in the Bay with some brothers. That always, every year he gives a Father's Day get together, you know, we all come together to represent, you know, being a good father. And we also gotta keep in mind that to be a good father, it means everything. And a lot of us wasn't good fathers. And so if you are a father, do what's right. Come together. And take care, you know, your responsibilities. One of my friends just lost his father. I talked to him last night, and he was devastated, you know, because he had said some things, put some things on Facebook, and he was like, man, you know, I shouldn't have did that. And I can understand and I agree, you know, because just like my father was never there for me, his father was never there for him as well, you know. But as a believing human being, it's our obligation to make sure that we be there, you know, for our father, for our kids. And then just keep in mind, Father's Day can be every day. It ain't gotta be a certain day. It can be every day. Every day we wake up, you know, call your pops, man, I love you. Or call your mother, I love you. Call your son, you know, I love you. The main thing is for us to be a better father. And I think, you know, the world would be a lot better. Because just think about all the kids that don't have no fathers, that ain't never seen their fathers. You know, so honor your father, honor your mother, you know, to the best of your ability, because guess what? Without them, we're nothing.
I agree. You know, it goes, especially when you see a lot of kids now in this generation, and maybe the generation before us, a lot of us wasn't taught how to honor our fathers. We weren't taught how to honor our fathers, honor our parents. Because we grew up and watched so much negativity going on when the parents could have been going here, there, doing whatever, and never spent the crucial and critical times with us to nourish us. And so we see maybe their bad habits, their destructive traits, whatever it may be, and cause us to have bitter tastes in our mouth. And then as we get older, we hold on to those same resentments. And those same resentments come off in a form of animosity. And as you say, we put stuff on these social medias. And then once you put it out there, we can't take it back. It's a hurtful thing. And then once we do lose that parent, lose a friend, or a loved one, whoever it may be, and it's a sudden tragedy, then we're like, damn. But in my opinion, it just goes back to where we still have to be, as you were saying, more humble, more honorable, and admonish ourselves that where we come from, about our humble beginnings.
Yeah, for me, I think Father's Day is symbolic of what we do every year, all year. Every time we wake up, you know, it's a responsibility. It's something that is supposed to be done with honor.
Yes.
So, you know, us coming from, you know, being incarcerated for a long period of time, you know, being away from our children, our parents, our mothers and fathers, our sisters and brothers, you know, it creates a void in people's lives, right? That once you come back, you know, and, you know, we it's like we've been in a capsule. You know, and we've been gave all these books while we're in this capsule to read about, you know, morality, ethics, religion, history, and all the things that it takes to have a family. And then when we get out, we gain this knowledge. And when we get out, you know, and we start viewing what a structural family is supposed to be, we start saying, wow. You start seeing the value of how important it was individually and collectively of us being there. When we was removed from the family, what it did.
Yeah.
You know, it our role was, I don't want to say decimated, but it decayed us, you know? But when we come back renewed, it's like, damn, I see the, you know, like, wow, you know, the effects of me being gone so long, you know, and then me trying to reconnect, you know? And it's a hurtful feeling.
Yes, it is.
But it's also, like, humbling, too. Like, you know, I'm so glad I'm back. Because just think if I would have got back too late, like you speaking on the brother that lost his father.
Yes.
You know, I lost my father in prison. I was in Solano. I was like 25, 26. I didn't know how to feel because I was in a war zone.
Yes.
So I couldn't feel like I want. I couldn't even really share that with you. I don't even think I did. All I know is, man, my father passed. I think I shared it with y'all. I mean, you was roommates, wasn't it?
I think it was around that time.
And it was just like, I didn't even get a chance to really mourn.
Yes.
You know? But when I got out, all those things, all those feelings came back. Like, you know, damn, I miss my dad. You know, then when I see my son, wow, I'm glad I'm his father. You know, it's that important. So, yeah, Father's Day, the first day, the Father's Day, the holiday, yeah, it's a powerful concept. But at the same time, you know, I feel like that every day.
Most every day, definitely.
You know, I value being a father. I value being a brother. I value being a husband. I value being a son. I value that now. Mm-hmm. And that's the thing that separation caused me, because I was able to sit back and see what my role was as a father, as a son, and what I did wrong. And right. For me to correct those things helped me become a better father.
Yes.
So I honor all those that, you know, look at it from that perspective. And even if they find it, or whether religion, creed, whatever it is, you know, it's very important that we understand our role as fathers, you know. So that's how I take it.
Yeah, most definitely. Let me touch on one thing, since we on Father's Day. You know, my father wasn't, he wasn't there for me as well. And you know, my father was, he passed away April 7th. And one of his wishes was to see me home before he passed over. And Allah granted that wish, God, he granted that wish, you know, for me to be home and to see my father, because he had COPD, you know, chronic lung disease. And he was suffering. And so, you know, being that he never did anything for me, I didn't hold that against him.
That's right.
You know, so I stepped up, you know, and did what I supposed to do as his son, you know, as my father. And I made sure, you know, that he, you know, that he was taken care of, you know, the best of my ability. You know what I mean? Just getting out of prison, you know, after doing almost 30 years. So now, I'm not gonna say it was a burden, I mean, but in a way it was a burden, because I'm trying to get my life together, you know. But, you know, Allah gave me the strength, you know, to deal with my father, you know, the best that I could, you know. And he was comfortable, and he you can see the joy, you know, in his eyes to see his, you know, to see his boy home.
That's right.
You know, and it was a beautiful thing, but it was also sad to me to see him in the situation, you know, his condition he was. You know, I mean, that hurted me. Even though he never did, anything for me, he was still, you know, my father. And so I'm saying this to say this, is that even though our parents might not been the best parents in our life, it's still our obligation to make sure that they taken care of when they're in a time of need. Because just think like this, you know, when we was young, when we was an infant, you know, they took care of us the best they could.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but at some point they might have fell off. But we can't hold that against them. We can't hold that animosity against them. Because like I said earlier, you know, it's our obligation to make sure that we take care, you know, our loved ones, you know, our father, our mother, and our siblings. You know, so those that's out there that's holding these grudges against their, you know, they pops or their moms, you got to get away from that. You know, we have to step up, you know, and be there, you know, be there for them, you know, be there for our father, be there for our, you know, our kids, as much as we can, because they are the future. And like I said, we have to give back, you know, to our parents, regardless if they did anything for us. And I just want to say this before I pass the mic on to Fahim, is that I struggled with this for many, 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 many years. But guess what? When I got out, I made sure I made peace with myself, made peace with him, and I made sure I took care of him.
Man, that's deep. That's real deep. Because as you talk about, you know, this theme of Father's Day and going back over 100 years that we all have done collectively, I'm one of many who didn't really know their dad, because my dad grew up in a life of crime and I haven't seen him since I was 9 years old. Approximately 9 years old. And the last time I remember talking to my dad, he gave a phone. He called my grandmother, and my grandmother passed me the phone. And she's reminded me this. Then one of the last words she said was, I'm gone, I don't know when I'm gonna see you again. You know, at that time I didn't understand. So, and here it is, 2020, at the age of 50. I haven't seen him or talked to him ever since. It's not because he neglected me. It's just based on the lifestyle that he had lived. And when he first came home from prison, I believe that was 1978, he had vowed to never go back, no matter what he done. And he kept his vow. And they've been looking for him ever since. The foundation of that is growing up. We have women, mothers who will look at their kids, you know, and sometimes in a negative light, to take things out on their kids based on what their father went through. And a lot of women, you know, they don't like to admit it, but it's true. I went through that, you know, with my mom. She never would admit it, but when she said certain things to me, I knew exactly what she was talking about. You're going to be just like your daddy. Your daddy did this, you did that. So basically you saying, I'm going to be like my father, or I'm going to end up like him, whatever it was. And part of that was true, because I looked up to my father not really knowing exactly everything what he was about, but just hearing who he was, how people looked up to him. And that was one of the things that led me to the street life. You know, trying to be like my dad, trying to live up to someone I shouldn't have, but even though that was my father. What I should have did at that young age was just took the good things I knew about him instead of everything. And so now when I look at myself, I said, look, Fahim, coming through the penal system, you don't want to be the ones to treat your daughter the same way as people had treated me towards my dad. And so that allowed me, during my time, to create a good bond between me and my daughter. And Dante contested this one time. I was going to preliminary here, and I had a lot going on. And I was mad at a lot of things, you know, myself, my situation, my daughter's mother. And when the baby was born, because she was in the wounds when I got arrested. And so when the baby was born, the first time I held my daughter was in court. It was their preliminary hearing. You know, my mother brought my daughter to me. But when my daughter, and she was, remember that? And yeah. She was real little. But prior to that, when my brother took her, in my mind was that my daughter's mother should have been the one to bring my daughter to me.
Yeah.
in the county jail when she was first was born. Not my mother had to say, here is your baby, during preliminary hearing in a courtroom in front of many, many people. But I held the resistance for a minute, and I had to grow up and let him go. And I told my daughter the story, but to this day, me and my daughter, we have a good bond. And I want to just say, for everyone, be humble, be a humble parent, and be a good servant to God, and let everything else take its course. Because being a father isn't easy, because we've been lied to, we've been misled, all type of things becoming a father. You know, a lot of women think they have it hard, but fathers, we have it hard. You know, a lot of us, we lose our kids, we get told this, we get told that. Sometimes we don't know what to believe, but we just got to just still hold on and have a solid resolve in who we are.
Yeah, listen to their two stories, it's like taking more in depth about, you know, if there's hurt and then there's joy.
Yes.
In both sides of it, right? Because I lost a father and a son, right? And I've never seen my father sober. My real father, is, you know, may he rest in peace, Paul Scott. And that did something to me as a youth. You know, seeing the image of my father, alcoholic. You know, every time I would see him, he'd be, incapacitated in terms of just drinking and drinking and drinking. And at that time, the early 70s, all the way up to, like, you know, from the time I came, you know, caught this case and was incarcerated in November 20, 1989, I can just remember the images of him. Every time I used to see him over my aunt's house, which is his sister, he used to be laying on the couch just toasted. You know, and I just try to go talk to him, and he just cried. Or he'll weep, he'll look at me, because he abandoned, alcohol was so abusive in his life, he abandoned his fatherhood. He couldn't be a father to me. So every time he would see me, I was getting closer and closer to the streets. You know, when I first started with clothes, then it started with, you know, carrying a gun, pagers, pulling up in cars. You know, I ain't working, you know, so, you know, he seen the road that I'm traveling. He didn't have no input of trying to stop me. And so, you know, I had a stepfather in my life. He's still with my mother 48 years, but it wasn't my real father, but he's my father. And he showed me unconditional love. We're talking about Will.
Right.
And when we got together, what was that, 2 weeks ago Sunday?
That was 2 weeks ago.
Oh, man, that was just... all my brothers came, man. My brother came down, my oldest brother, my youngest brother, of course, which y'all know, Maurice, and our kids. And it was just like, I think it was like close to a little bit over 20 of us there. But all of us there, and my mom has dementia. My stepfather took care of her, man, for the whole time I was gone away in prison. So when we talk about fathers, man, that's a father.
Yes, absolutely.
And, you know, when he's seen all of us together, he haven't seen us together in over 30 years. Mm. And when we got together, you know, he just cried. And everybody was emotional about it. He cried like a baby, man. And, you know, that let me know that I'm doing the right thing. You know, being the responsibility. All I told him was, man, I'm here now. You know, the banner you carry, I should continue on with the same banner. That's the example of being a father. You know what I mean? And that made me, how can I put it? As you put it, like, forgave my real father.
Yeah.
Because I actually seen him going through feeling like, man, I'm not being a father to my son. I love him to death, and I'm so caught up in this disease, which is alcohol. You know, he abandoned that, and so he abandoned me, and it left me a free-for-all for the streets.
Yeah.
Because God, fathers are there to be guided. And when I went to prison, I suffered from my son getting, you know, murdered in 2018, February 2018. And so, when Homicide came up there to Tracy Prison and talked to me about it, I didn't know how to feel. Mm. The first thing I felt, though, is I failed him as a father.
Yes.
You know, we could sit up and say all day, yeah, man, you know, in terms of, you know, man, you should be a good father. When you lose a parent or you lose a child and you have to sit there and really relish in what that child or father meant to you, that's when you recognize, man, I could have been a better father. Or you can say, I did the best I could. And I want to be one of them type of guys to say, I did the best I could. I didn't hold nothing back. I didn't relinquish my position as a man, nor as a father, nor as a son, nor as a, you know what I mean, a grandson or whatever the case may be, even if it's not my mother or people I meet, just like I met, what was her name yesterday? The boy's mother that invited me in, she treated me like a mother.
Oh, his sister, Ronnie?
Ronnie.
Yeah. Right.
That's what it is. Mm-hmm. That was like a mother to me.
Mm-hmm.
She really mothered me. She didn't, you know, set to me as her one of her sons.
Right.
And that's what we're supposed to do for young men in the community.
Exactly.
You know, so just because we lose a family member, right, it's about what you did when that family member was still alive, whether you was a father or a son to him. And that's important, because if you do that, then you can be a leader in the community.
Mm-hmm.
You can't be a leader of the community when you're not a guiding light to your family. You know, because you're not going to look, you're not going to be looked upon for that leadership. But sometimes we fall in relationships, like you was telling me, DT, about, man, it's hard. You know what makes it hard is because we accepted the responsibility.
Yes.
And once we accept the responsibility, people start to look for us for that.
Yes.
Same thing with this podcast.
Mm-hmm.
It's not a coincidence that we're here talking about things that matter most to us, because we have accepted the role. A lot of us just like, I'm not willing to do that.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Oh, man, I could be a father of this child, but I ain't messing with this one because I'm not cool with the mother. And you can't do that. It's an unconditional position that you got to do, but God has bestowed upon man to be in position to take care of his family, regardless what it is. And just this morning when I was in the car with good brother Fahim picked me up, man. He come pick me up. I can kiss him in the mouth. You know, he just take me on war tour. I'm having a blast.
Yeah, you know.
So, but the point is that I called my son's mother. I had to call him and say, y'all not going to wish me. I called the one when my son is deceased. May he rest in peace, Patrick Jr. And I asked her, I said, you're not going to wish me Father's Day? Because I deemed that important. I was in this life the whole time I was in prison. And they know. I brought little Patrick to come visit. I made sure they come visit. You know what I mean? And sometimes we get caught up in the bureaucracy of it all. You know, you in jail.
Yeah.
You know, so that relinquishes me being a father. You know what I mean? That's not like I'm not trying to be in this life. But she said to me she didn't want to get in and have any coming between what I got going on. I said, what that got to do with me being a father? We mature, we are knowledgeable,
right?
We're God-fearing, we pray five times a day, right? That we can't get caught up in that.
Yeah.
That's the mess that been there before when we was gone. This is the stuff we was going to get back and say we was going to do.
Mm-hmm.
Get back and be men.
Mm-hmm.
So men have to take on responsibility. What the saying is, and I'm going to pass the mic because I don't want to be long.
Right. You got time.
Heavy is the head that wears the crown. You want to be a king?
Mm-hmm.
When you put that crown on, you can't take it off and sit on the bed and say, I ain't the king, man.
That's full time. Give me 30 minutes.
When you wake up, they're going to come by your bedside and say, sire, how you want your eggs? You can't say, man, just make it any way you want to.
Right.
They ain't going to move.
They need a direction.
Yeah.
Bam, right there.
Direction.
So, you know, it's a full time job.
I was the opposite, right? Mm-hmm. I wasn't looking for the Happy Father's Day.
Right, right.
For my baby mama, right? For my daughter's mama, I wasn't looking for it, you know, because I ain't seen it so damn long. But anyway, I don't hold nothing against her, whatever. I love her for having my daughter.
Right.
And so I go to my Facebook messages, and I see a Happy Father's Day from her.
Mm-hmm.
I cracked a little smile, you know what I'm saying? Told her thank you and everything.
Mm-hmm.
But it was beautiful because we expect certain things and certain things we don't expect. But whatever it is, what we don't expect, whatever we view a deem what is detrimental or what's going to cause us any type of friction, we got to let it go.
Definitely.
If that's good, let's carry it.
Definitely.
Well, you got to have unconditional love.
Mm-hmm.
Because at one
under
point,
no condition.
At one point,
yeah,
you and her loved each other. Y'all made a child together.
Yeah.
I always go back to those moments.
Right.
That's what checked me.
I chose.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
So when I think about that, right? I want to be that kind of man, father,
mm-hmm,
God-fearing man that I claim to be,
mm-hmm,
to where if something was to happen to her,
mm-hmm,
you know, or she ended up in a hospital,
mm-hmm,
you know, God forbid, that I'll be type of man that go see her and say, hey, I'm not holding that against you.
Mm-hmm.
I'm the father, you the father of my child.
Mm-hmm.
That's how important Father's Day is.
Mm-hmm.
We can't, you know what I'm saying? Our value system has to change. Mm-hmm. It's nothing you can say. If I'm feeling great, it's nothing you can do to stop me from feeling great.
Period.
Right.
So what you gonna wish me happy
father? I'm just reminding you. I'm reminding you that I am a father.
Right.
You know what I mean? Yeah. I'm reminding you. I'm taking that paternal. Excuse me. I like to, how you doing? And she come through the phone with something. I said, this is Father's Day. Ain't you gonna wish me happy Father's Day? I'm doing that for the sake of, I'm a father.
Mm-hmm. For real. One more.
Mm-hmm. You can't take it from me.
Exactly.
You know what I mean? And to the day you die, I'm going to be a father. And the day I die, I'm going to be a father. And if anything happen to you, I'm going to still be a father. And I'm going to be there with God as a man.
Mm-hmm. Right. I'm
with that. See? And the society needs that. Mm-hmm. We got to get out of this culture of being a gangster or a pimp or player. Because we're out of the pimp code.
Yeah.
If you say smack a hole down, you know, because the pimp code say so, you don't smack that hole down. That's what I'm saying.
Yeah. Exactly.
When it comes to something honorable, we want to take something off of it. Mm-hmm. When it comes to some buffoonery,
we want to add
negativity, we going to put all much on it. I'm put 10 coats of paint. Candy apple red. You're going to see my candy. It's going to be the loudest candy apple red you ever seen.
Try to be the best you can be.
So, you know, I try to make light of it, man, because we going now. You know, I had a shot of coffee.
Yeah,
man, I love these dudes. This took me back to the pitches. We made this instant.
Yeah.
Ain't nothing better than instant.
I mean, you know, like I say, Father's Day is important, and you know, we just need to step up and do what we're supposed to do, you know, as fathers. I mean, because hey, it's already written, you know, for us. And we just have to adhere to it. You know, a lot of people don't want to adhere to it. You know, we want to second job our responsibilities. You know, just step up and be a man. Mm-hmm. I mean, he was able to, you know, to lay down, you know, with this female and get her pregnant. I mean, so, hey, take on your responsibilities. And, you know, and me personally, I don't like to see a cat not handling its responsibilities. I mean, come on.
Right.
You know, that's my son. I ain't doing what you mean. You ain't doing nothing for your son or for your daughter. Man, that's crazy. Mm. No, even though I didn't have my mother there, but I had my grandparents there. You know, and that was, you know, my grandfather, you know, that was my daddy. Mm-hmm. My grandmother, that was my mama. Because they took care of me. I mean, really took care of me. And so it's like, to see somebody not doing for theirs, that just don't sit right with me. I don't have no biological kids, but I got 3 stepkids, and I've been in their lives since they was little, you know. And I was a father through the penitentiary, so if you can't be a father out here on the street, you know, you was a lazy man.
You was a dump truck.
Hey, you was a dump truck.
Hey, you was a real dump truck, man. You know, and continue to tear the garbage. Hey, it's, you know, here I am at age 50.
I like that.
Right? And here I am at age 50. I never knew if I was going to have another child again. I must say, my fiance, Keisha, she know I love her. Right now, she's about 2 months pregnant, you know, with my seed. And thank you very much. So now, I really have a chance, you know, God willing, to really just be there, you know, from the womb to the cradle to everything, man. And that's as our brother Raheem was just saying, and brother Sam Housing, all of us up in here, I have to be that responsible man, that responsible human being, you know, to my child, be it a girl or a boy. I'm going to be there. Yep, unconditionally. I'm going to be there every step of the way. Mm-hmm. You know, if I got to go to gym class, if I got to go to boxing, if I got to go to swimming, whatever it is, you know, change them diapers. I never change the diapers. So when I get to doing all that, stand up late night, oh, I'm going to smile.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm going to smile and, I might, you know how some parents want to take the child from the day?
Mm-hmm.
I might be the one to take my child from the day. Let's go, because it's a beautiful thing, because you never know when it's going to happen, especially in our teenage years, because we just going, we humping around.
Mm-hmm.
But then when you finally, you know, you have a job, you take your responsibilities, you paying bills, and you got someone there on your side who love you and you love them,
mm-hmm.
And then when you see that she's carrying your seed, and now you see in the stomach growing and the things that she's going through, her emotional state, her anger. One day she want me to touch her, one day she don't. She cussing me out, then she loving me. Mm-hmm. I had to really just understand. I had to ask him and another guy about that, you know. And they tell me, you know, things I'm going to be going through. Yep. And so, because I didn't go through it on my first one. It happened. I was incarcerated. But now just going through it is hard. It's a well wish and a well deserved Happy Father's Day every day.
Yes, sir.
You know, and I want to just share that. And another thing, when a lot of children that's missing out here in the society from their fathers, well, to mothers, because we see it when we see all these riots, all these protesters, a lot of them really don't know why they doing it, because of so much destruction and anger behind it, yeah. Or they follow everyone else. Same thing we did when we went to the streets. And as fathers, as parents, what we have to do, what needs to be done now, we have to go back and take them to the foundation, which is the education.
Yes.
We have to really, as fathers and as parents, we have to really educate our kids about why that statue was going down, why Jim Crow was here, mm-hmm. who Christopher Columbus was, mm-hmm. why AC-65 was the way it was, or what allowed that, what was chattel slavery, what was the... African slave trade. What all that was about? You know what I'm saying? How we was forced to adopt a religion that wasn't ours. Mm-hmm. Why we was praying this way? Why we start praying this way? Why we ate this way? All those things, what the children don't know now because they took it away from our schools and our educational system, it's going to be amongst us and upon us to get that back the best way we can. And this podcast is so beautiful because we had a chance behind the walls to read certain books and to get certain understandings to give it back. And through this microphone, through the podcast, it's a beautiful thing because whoever listened to this, they can say, what them guys talking about? Right. Let's go back and read some books. Or they can make an email us or go online to the Instagram or to the YouTube and find us. And say, what's the best book I can read? What can I do? You know, what's this is really about? Because a lot of them are being misled just by news, yeah. By CNN, by Fox, exactly. You know what I'm saying, by the powers that be who control the networks.
So, both sides to the middle.
Right, yeah. So those who control the networks, they can put anything out there for to where they have, how they want to for us to get it, and then we gonna take it. They say the sky's purple today. We gonna say the sky's purple.
We gonna argue with it.
We gonna argue, yeah. Just because the media said it, because right. The so-called president said it. You know, do this and do that. But we have to go back to our basic education. I want to just add that with it.
But you know. You said a mouthful, right? Which I love. That's why I love being with y'all, right? Because, you know, I got to add this spirit to it. You know, Islam, right, kind of like, through all the knowledge we got, we incurred a lot of knowledge in Islam, too. And what it is, it's about, when it says being a man, right, it incurs great responsibility and protection, right? So if you a man, right, and you a father and you a husband, right, you have to not only protect yours, you got to protect those that you in charge of. Mm-hmm. You know, so say for instance, give you an example. You know, when Fahim was saying about having a child and having a son, then hopefully it's a son. I want it. I hate all the females. I take a daughter too, but I want him to have a son, right? I want that for you. But if you have a daughter, I'm going to put a baseball cap on her too.
That's right.
But the thing is that when he's speaking of, you know, having a son, I'm already looking at being responsible as a father to his son.
Right.
Because of the love and the brotherhood. If he have a son, or he have a nephew, or if he adopt a child, or he have a nephew, a cousin, a little brother come through, that's my son too. Mm-hmm. See, the teaching has indoctrinated me to believe in us. Father goes beyond just saying father to my own.
That's right.
See, because we was in the 70s, we had that.
Yeah.
That's what the Panthers and all that was about.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. So here comes hip-hop. Hip-hop comes along, it started off real good. It started from Beat Street and breakdance and all that, with a beat drum and all that, which came from Africa. Now, we have it to where when we came into a hip-hop form, right, the constable was no cussing at first.
Yeah.
You know, Run DMC didn't have him cuss. You know, Eric B. and Rakim didn't come, he was a scientist. He's calling him a scientist, right? I still listen to his bars a day.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So now, in the 80s, here we go. when they talk about the media, you know. We had the NWA, not knocking them, because I love NWA, one of my favorite rap groups. But the concept of gang banging and all that became glorified to the point to where it's, that became the fathers of the streets. Yeah. We all got caught up in it.
Yeah.
Because I guarantee you, that day when we caught our crime, we had some gangster rap on.
Right. And let me just say this, interject just one thing, Frank. And with the gangster rap, with the NWA, the first thing what they do, they put in the movie theater, I had just left, was Colors.
It's Colors, y'all.
Everybody ran up in there and came back out a different way.
But it's not a bad thing for them to view that. We're not saying, we're saying that when you indoctrinate a child with those views, or should I say those concepts, right, that goes unchecked. And what I mean by unchecked, it's not a father in the home. You know, it's not an example of seeing the father, the brother, the uncle. Because just because the father's not home, the brother's supposed to be there. The uncle's supposed to be there. You know, we had that. You know, and of course, dope came through and spread through our communities. But I'm just saying, we had a value system. You know, now our value is YouTube. Mm-hmm. You know, and that means everything. It say whatever you can sell.
Everything.
Your morals, your ethics, your culture, whatever. You know, seeing other cultures, you know, and not to be, you know, go too deep, to see them use the N word stronger than I ever did.
That's great.
It's powerful. You know what I mean? Right. And this goes back to fathers. I was in Susanville. I had got transferred. I was with them, and I cried like a baby too. But when I got transferred up there, I had a blood from L.A. is my partner. He was cool with me. Mm-hmm. And he was in the cell with some Southsiders next to us, and they was listening to rap music, and they was just in this. And I'm not saying I use the word, because I ain't even brought the rules here. But he was so hot in the cell. He doing push-ups, he taking his shirt off. So I'm just sitting there looking. I'm over myself now. Yeah. I used to be wanting to go whatever the dope pop, I'm ready. But as I got older, I start realizing, right, like Pac-Man the Colors, you know. I say, man, you know, why is you upset so much, right? So he like, man, you sitting there using the word, N-word over there, man. I'm getting ready to go bust their head over there, right? So I'm saying, if you go, I got to go, right? So I said, man, just calm down. When I got him to calm down, I say, listen. Yeah. Just listen. I just need you to listen for 10 minutes. Please, and we can do whatever you want to do after that. So I got him to listen for 10 minutes. He said, and they listen to some of that. I said, they listen to the rap music. I said, there's another thing I want you to read. I said, what? They calling themselves nigga.
Yeah.
They ain't referring it just to us no more.
Mm-hmm. Call themselves. Mm-hmm.
So we got to get out of saying, because originally we were saying, man, you can't use our word niggas. Right. They refer to us. Yeah. No, we don't.
It's a term of endearment.
Mm-hmm. They use it to the point, we niggas.
Yep.
Yep. Right? So now we're saying, I'm not that.
Yeah, you go ahead and be that fool.
You go
ahead and
be that.
Right, you go ahead.
I'm not that.
Let me pass the baton.
So I ain't gonna get mad because I hear Mexican said, French said, or white kid said. I ain't what I'm mad for. Right. They've been calling that for 400 years.
Right, no.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Right. Now I'm at a point in maturity to say, you know what? I ain't that, and I'm not gonna call myself. I'm not gonna refer to my friends that. If that's what y'all wanna do, y'all go ahead. Cause that's how it was in reverse when you had the European culture did us the same way.
Mm-hmm.
Exactly.
But they do. They forced us to accept it.
Right.
So you can accept it or reject it.
Right.
Yeah. Well, you know, I ain't never been fond of that word. I seen Roots when I was young, and that just blew my mind. You know, as a young kid, right, and I used to go to a school called Shannon in Pinole, all white school. I think I probably was like a third or fourth black in that school. And them kids used to call me niggas, and I used to take off on them, you know. And I was young, in the third grade, you know, get sent to the principal's office. She used to give us whoopings, just ruler. But your parents had to sign a consent.
On the ruler.
Yeah, you know, I stayed up in there. You know, but I ain't never been fond of that word. And we really need to educate ourselves. And it hurts me to see, you know, our folks to use that word, you know, nigga, nigga, nigga. I'll be like, I mean, for real? I mean, come on. You know, and especially when you talk to me, don't call me no nigga.
Right.
Dante. You know, so address me that way, because that's a to me, it's a degrading name. That's what the white folks, you know, called us, you know, back in the days, you know, to degrade us, you know, as human beings. And that ain't cool. You know, so we all need to, you know, educate ourselves on that word, because one for sure that I ain't no nigga, and I ain't gonna disrespect you and call you a nigga. Like I say, if I do, I was hella pissed off.
Yeah. It's deep, man. It's deep. Yeah.
That's right. That's right.
Because Tupac said a long time ago, he said, never ignorant, getting goals accomplished. Mm-hmm. You know, so that's what we got to do. And that's what we got to explain to these youth. I know it's hard to get across to them because they caught up and they certain lifestyle, they certain way of living. And, I got a guy who work at my job, and that's all he say. You know, black guy. And so while we doing stretcher flags, he talking to the white boys and messing with my knees. So one time I say, hey, man, check this out. I say, he called me, what's up, OG? I say, now one of them call you that, how you gonna feel? Oh, no. I said, what you mean you don't know? Mm-hmm. He said, well, I'm just, you know, this is how we talk. He said, but you came up in a different time. I understand where you come from, right? I say, yeah, I come up in a different time, but you have to really understand what it means. And so he told me that he never really knew what it meant. He knew it was almost like somewhat derogatory, but never really had a true essence of the word. Because growing up in a society, in our culture, on our streets, before the YouTubes, before the Instagrams, at 3, 4, 5 years old, they get inside their households. So once they get inside a household, we're coming out the speakers or whatever. Could be the colors, could be the NWA. Now, we grew up at 17, 18 years old in the NWA era. So they get, so he is, he's 30 years old, 28, 30 years old. So he's getting it from the, what came out 30 years ago? From the Lil Wayne's now.
He's 30.
That's their era.
Yeah, he's
30. You know, he's 30, so he had to get it 20 years ago. You know, probably a little young enough from their little eras. So it's a disease. It's a systematic disease that's still trickling and permeating through the bloodstream, through the mind, through the body, and through the soul in a negative way. And that's why us as being responsible men, responsible parents, responsible people to the society, we have to find a way, even if we just getting one person to stop or to change his thinking or change her thinking, then we done a good thing. Because you cannot chop down a mountain, understand me, in 3 chops. No. You know what I'm saying? It ain't gonna happen. You can't cut down a house, you know what I mean, in one swipe of the sword. So we gotta just nip at it, chop at it, and knowing we doing our job.
But you know what? I beg to differ. This is the point I want to make, and this is good. Because we had great examples of men, right? Sometimes you have to outgrow it, right? Meaning that I had youngsters tell me recently, just yesterday, said the N-word to me, said, oh, OG, I apologize for that. He was like saying, directing, he used the word, but he's not using the word towards me.
Right.
Because he said, I recognize you being a black man. I recognize you being a real OG.
Now he got that from somebody.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, but what I'm saying is, the point I'm making is that you ain't gonna just look at Farrakhan and say, nigga.
You're not.
You ain't gonna look at Muhammad Sharif and call him nigga.
Yeah, absolutely.
You ain't gonna look at Martin Luther King and call him nigga. You ain't gonna look at Farrakhan because you know.
Yeah.
You know them not, they not that. Awesome. It's the way you carry yourself. So when you hear a group of people call themselves that, that's because they believe in that. It's something that we had to come, because when Muhammad Sharif came and we met him, he blew our mind. We was calling each other niggas back then. I remember that time. I'm not saying that
Muhammad Sharif, he forced us. He came with something different. Remember, we used to walk to the child. He opened the door, told him, where y'all going? Come get this education.
Exactly.
That's how he got. He said he came from Africa. Said, I got a manuscript. I'm not finna be here long. But Airbnb, I gotta break it down. Cause I'm telling y'all, these folks finna have me up out of here, because I'm giving y'all this Islam raw and uncut. I look like y'all, I talk like y'all, but I'm teaching y'all something different. And the system not gonna have me here. He came in 1995, the end of 97, beginning of 98, they had him out of there for giving it to us, what he's talking about.
Okay, so what I'm saying, my point is, so that is, they're saying that, not one time in that era,
right,
and thank God I'm to be law. Because I feel I'm a part of this fraternity.
Yeah.
But not one time did we ever call him the word ninja.
Absolutely not.
Right? Because we knew. We knew that instinctively that he wasn't that.
Yeah.
So I'm saying when it go back to us, the way we carry ourselves now, when I look at Rakim, I say, man, that's a man.
Right.
I'm not gonna call him that.
But how you got it, Cameron, you came from Pelican Bank this long, right? And you knew what's gonna happen. That's 100 push-ups automatically. Well, a little bit lower. So we had a discipline going on too, coming up, yeah, coming through that. These guys ain't being disciplined all the way.
Right, but I'm saying we come from that. Mm. We was there at first.
That's the difference.
You know, we had to come in.
Yeah.
It was friends of mine that came in, that knew I was from Bushrod Park, whatever right. the case may be, and the first thing ring, Cyrene, my nigga.
Yeah.
Hold on, man.
Right.
And after he watched me for a month or two, 3 months, you really changed. See, so what I'm saying is that it's the development of the man that causes another man to respect you.
Right.
You know what I mean?
And so I agree with that.
So when we go amongst the youth, right, and we don't have to beat their head in by using a rug. Just don't call me that, man.
Yeah, and that's how you convey a message to them.
Right. And when you do, because it's going to be a message because you're amongst them. So just your walk is going to be a message.
Absolutely.
Because Fahim, believe it or not, man, you got symptoms of greatness. I can see it.
Yeah.
Rakim, I can see it. We changed from who we were before.
Absolutely.
So now that's why we able to sit here and talk about, you know, why we don't do that.
Yeah.
Because we don't.
We don't.
You know what I mean? So it's you know, getting back to the Father's Day, that's, we just talk about going to the dialogue about these are conversations we have regularly. This ain't no, like, fucking right.
That's what we do.
Talk like this.
That's what you do.
Tell me, let me, and so you get a young man hang with us, because my son, he just look at me. We be talking, I be talking to somebody, he just looking. But like, what's up? He said, I just tripping on you, Pop.
Right.
So, that's the we call about reform. When you have men that come amongst us that do things that's according to what Allah say, do I just say God for the sake of, or just in a spiritual matter? Because I don't want to, you know, promote anything that has people thinking that's just what this segment about.
Right.
This is about being a better man, a better human being, you know what I mean, for your community. Our community is suffering. And the most important thing is symbolic by Father's Day.
Mm-hmm.
You know? So, I met great men and made, I just look, Abdul Rauf.
Yeah, Abdul Rauf. Good man.
I never called him a ninja.
No.
You know what I mean? And I might have called somebody next to him that. I ain't called him that. And he just sit back and laugh.
Yeah, smile.
And he need to stop using that word. You know what I mean? But I was younger than him. But I got older and I recognized without him telling me, man, I'm a man, I'm supposed to be responsible. Mm-hmm. I got to carry myself in a different manner. And so that's what I'm saying. All you have to do is lead by example. Like you did yesterday at the thing. You led by example. You know what I mean? When you went by and did what you did. You know what I mean? You could speak on it, but that was what men do.
Absolutely.
So, I feel very happy by talking about that subject.
Yeah, it's good. Because we got to lead by example. It's like, for instance, y'all met the two young brothers a couple weeks ago that had exercise. You know, they real shy. And my brother Maurice, we real close, grew up together. And those are his sons.
Mm-hmm.
And so, as we grow up, you know, we talk about teaching and education, being fathers to those who might be a biological connection to us or not. They're not my blood, but I treat them as they're my blood.
Mm-hmm.
And so, I have to, they're not used to being told or led in a way to where they have to be open. They used to being, you know, to want to close with themselves. And so, oftentimes, well, recently, I had to tell them when somebody come to the fitness program, to the session, you know, they won't say anything. So now to tell a man, hold on, don't just speak to me. Whoever walk up, you got to speak. You know, and so they had to really be reformed to do that. Because growing up, they wasn't really taught to do it. They just go, okay, and be quiet. He walked up. You know what I mean? I had to make them. Man, y'all better start speaking. Another little sister come up. So now, I saw him yesterday. I didn't say anything. Right? It's an example. So people coming up, they may look at me, I don't say nothing. They start speaking now. But those are the things that we got to give.
Mm-hmm.
Because we might have it, but some of them today don't have it.
Never got it.
Because so much goes on, mm-hmm. you know, and they so versed in these video games yeah. and this and that. So when they see us, when they see the adults, you got to come in, say, how you do, the way you come in is where you're finna leave. For instance, my woman's daughter, boyfriend, I done sat back a few times. He might come to the house, you know what I'm saying? Everybody, you know, how you doing? And then when he leave, he don't say nothing. So my girl never's kind of irking me. So 2 weeks ago, he walked in, you know, so he's about to leave. I say, hey, man, come here. He said, huh? I say, look, check this out. The way you walk in this house is the way you finna leave. Mm-hmm. So my girl just looking at me like, oh. But, just you know how I am. So from then to this point, he'll come in, the way he speak, and before he leave, he gonna be the same way. Exactly. Because I can kind of find out, he wasn't used to doing that.
Right.
And he 22 years old. He wasn't used, so a lot of these kids, they're not used to being respected and knowing how to show respect. A lot of they not, because they go to and fro. You know, constantly.
Because they're not getting it from the home, because it starts in the home. That's where it starts at, inside the home.
Yes.
You know, certain things that I see now, I would never get at my parents like that. I get slapped in the mouth, soap in the mouth. I think my mouthwash was soap one time.
Yeah.
You know, and that didn't taste good. Boy, you out there cussing and put some soap in my mouth and wash my mouth out. Yeah. You know, so I mean, I had, you know, much respect. For my parents, for the elders, not just my parents, but the neighbors. You know, if you was old, I had to respect you. If I didn't, they gonna call my grandmother, and guess what? She gonna come down wherever I'm at with some switches and get on my behind.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so I mean, the respect level it's out the door. You know, with these kids nowadays, it's like, you know, how they respond, you know, to you, and be like, that ain't acceptable. That, I mean, back in our time, that wasn't acceptable.
You know? Matter of fact, as you said, what's a lady said across the street from you, next door to Mark's Mouton, they had a pretty house and everything?
Miss Hall now?
Now, look, we might sell dope houses on the two apartments, on the corner, two more apartments diagonal from each other, or next door to his house, or the apartments next door on both sides, but never in front of her house, because we see how she driving, how we left, and how she left.
Yeah.
And we knew. We ain't finna do that.
You hanging out with people,
and
gonna do
and
that.
We gonna say something. No, go over here, go down there.
Man, because this ain't
yeah.
right here.
And we was young, we teenagers then.
Yeah.
You know, so we need to really get back on, you know, like I said, we need to really get back on that for respecting, you know, our elders, respecting our parents, you know. But as I said before, it starts in the home. And if I'm in the home, and guess what, and I haven't been taught these values, then how am I gonna teach it to my kids?
Mm-hmm.
You know, so we need to find a way to make sure that they got it too, so they can pass it on to their kids. Because, I mean, you just look around today; these kids is so disrespectful.
Man,
you know. And I'm glad I'm not the person I used to be, because it'd be a lot of headbusters. I mean,
yeah.
They don't disrespect me in any kind of way. I don't care who you is, you know. But I'm a humble person now, and now it's all about growing and teaching those that don't know. Because, like the brother just said, you know, youngsters they don't know because they haven't been taught. They haven't been told that, you know. So if I don't know, then I don't know. So yeah, I'm gonna come through the house and ain't say nothing. I'm leaving. Ain't gonna say because I wasn't taught that. So we really need to, you know, as grown men, as men, we really need to, you know, teach ours and those that ain't ours. We need to give it to them.
You had a system, right, that removed so many black men got killed. So many black men are gay. So many black men are in jail. So many black men are in the military. And those that was left that we consider, you know, I'm not saying all of them, but a lot of them was busters.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of them was like the end of the pack.
Mm-hmm.
And they was scared. So they stayed in the house when we was doing the shooting and doing all the little stupid stuff, the guys in jail. Mm-hmm. And they came outside when it got cleared out. And they owned the block.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So now they walking down the street with soft shoe chronos.
Yeah.
You know, they got the reputation because Cat Steel, it might have took two, maybe two, 3 years for a cat to get bold enough. So I'm going over there and take that. Because DT and Fahim and Cyreen is gone. But just the fact that we was in jail fighting our case and, like, you know, it was so political that, you know, I ain't going over there. I remember how them cats get out and whoever soldiers he was with, they still over there. right? So now what happened was you had a wave of black men that was solid, got removed from society.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm talking about that just in the Bay Area. I'm talking about all over the United States,
yeah.
Right? For what they call crack cocaine.
Yeah, crack right? epidemic.
Now, 30 years later, we say a good 30 years, they come to the same black men to come back to the communities to do what? Self-help development program. They got those counselors. Mm-hmm. They got, it's so disrespectful how they play the game.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they need us, because they couldn't do nothing. They, you know, when they removed us, that's when the youngsters went crazy. Mm-hmm. My uncle in jail, my daddy in jail.
Yep.
You killed my partner, mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Ain't nobody hollering at them about how it go. And the game they get passed down, yep. Because you got these cats that was left that's, you know, had hate for those who went in or whatever the case may be. It's all negative. I'm not putting no banner on none of it.
Right.
But, you know, I ain't about to pass the game down. I'm getting ready to, you know, eat off the spoils.
Mm.
You know what I mean? I'm getting ready to kept all the women.
Yeah.
I'm getting ready to sell all the dope.
Mm.
You know what I mean? Because when they was out, I couldn't do it.
Man.
You know what I mean? And I'm going to be Big Eddie Spaghetti.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And a king to be boo, as we say. And it was all false.
Yes.
You know, and so when we get back, you know, some of these cats, we have to do them like Shaka Zulu did his brother.
Mm-hmm.
You ain't no real king.
Yeah.
You know, you sitting on a podium, man. You ain't earned that.
Mm-hmm.
You misled all these young brothers.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you got this land foreign.
Yeah.
I come to my own neighborhood and I can't even recognize nothing. Yeah. And you over here talking about, hey, welcome back.
Yeah.
So, you know, we got to look at it for what it is. You know, the society as a whole, yeah, you know, they fed off us and removed us and put a whole new people in.
And then throw them out the way and come out and say to people.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? This was the Bay Area. This was Chocolate City.
Yes, exactly. It used to be.
This was Chocolate City. Before Washington, before Chicago, before, well, you think the Black Panthers started all over there? It started in Oakland,
mm-hmm.
West Oakland, then Richmond, then East Coast, then Chicago. They still hold those banners today, but it started here. This was the first Chocolate City.
Exactly.
You say that, you go outside, you will be like, what at the... But, you know, hey.
You know, how dare you?
Get off my block. You know what I mean? So, you know, I just want to remind us that, you know, it's a historical fact to it all. You know, Muhammad Sharif taught us that, you know, you got to search and look at... That's why education is so important. Because if you understand the historical events that took place and what came into power, then you understand what's going on today. You know, so, you know, you can't just look out your window and say, you know, man, them kids belong to somebody.
Mm-hmm.
You got to look at the parents, grandmother, the grandfather, the great-grandfather all the way back to recognize who that child is. You know, so, you know, it's a lot of that we got to meet that challenge.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because, you know, when I went to the thing yesterday, it was brothers that have been there all their life.
Mm-hmm.
In that neighborhood, as it should be.
Yeah.
We should always be able to go home. We shouldn't go home and then we can't knock on the door. Mm. I went to my neighborhood, I couldn't knock on the damn door. I'm talking, I've been going 30 years, I went to my neighborhood and couldn't knock on them. I went up in the Bushrod Park and went up in there, me and Fahim, they had, you know, white folks walking around with their dogs and stuff. And I ain't mad at them, that's just what it's life. It's, you know what I mean? But I'm saying, I couldn't say, man, I remember Kevin just stayed right there. He's still, hey, mama, how you?
Yeah,
that is over with.
Yeah. Or you walk over there, and it's like foreign soil. Cause they gonna look at you, what the hell you doing over here?
Right.
You know, like last time I had to tell a lady, listen, I was born in the house. The house been over 50-some years ago.
Mm-hmm.
She mean, what are you doing there? But I know why you doing it. I know how you got there, but yeah.
So, you know, it's a beautiful thing, man. But again, I wanna say, happy Father's Day.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I'm feeling glad and glorious. Love it. I love my struggle. You know, I don't even have a driver's license right now, and I'm happy.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? And it's just, it's because I understand what life is about. I understand what being a father is about. I understand what responsibility is. I understand about being a God-fearing man. I understand the significance of prayer.
Mm-hmm.
I understand the significance of community.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, that makes me happy because I'm active in all those things. And I may not be able a blip on the radar, but that's okay. But if you bring them magnifying out real close, you'll see me. You know what I mean? So, you know, I thank God that I'm here, man. I appreciate having the time to speak, and it feels good, and it seems like I'm getting better as we all, as we warm it up. Yeah. And I think we're going to have a good
and
time.
And he has old school a shot of instant coffee, some folds.
Oh, man, I had a shot of instant coffee, man, with some creamer, man. Yeah. Jailhouse shot.
You knocked it all down? Let me see that, man.
We should have had these mics in jail. Look. We could have sit and talk about this, because, hey, you know what? Yeah. They got a podcast of San Quentin, but you can learn so much from guys that have been in prison. Because we are very educated in terms of life itself and struggle.
We can have a podcast, send a link up in there. Instead of sending to the COs, they say, nah, you ain't getting this. Because that's what they're going to do. You can send it to your homeboy, pass a phone down, and listen to this, listen to this. And they can then what they can do, after they heard it, they can tell their families, their loved ones, I just heard this. Go to Spotify, listen to this. Go to YouTube, listen to this. Go to Instagram. Let these brothers doing out there. They got a thing out there called CoBiz, inviting people in. Yeah. You know, and they got these brothers out here doing this and doing that. For real. Because when you take away the communication of a person, you change their whole thinking, their whole dialogue. You cut them up. That's castration. That's mental, physical castration. That's what happened many, many years ago. They took off what? Our primary communication and forced you to communicate another way with through language.
Mm-hmm. Right now, I'm in the process of establishing my nonprofit organization, right? I want to give myself some room in terms of just, you know, acclimating. Like I said, I'll say it again, it's dorothy.org, which means Defenders of Real Truth, Helping Youth. I have a logo, but I want to save it, you know what I mean, because I'm still refining it. My nonprofit organization is going to approach it that way. Mm. You know what I mean? I don't see why we should learn French at 12, 13, 8. You know what I mean? Why we ain't learning these things to help you understand commerce. So when you get to a certain age, you don't know exactly what college you're in, where you want to go, and why. You know what I mean? You can't wait till you 17, 18. Oh, I'm going to go to college because I play football. No. You're going to college because you want to major in world economics. You major in econ. You major in business administration. You major in, you have that concept already. And until you get that indoctrinated into your community of brothers who been there and done that and being incarcerated and understand the keys of life, because we had Nurin. We watched Nurin, a CO, and I'm going to get off this point.
Yeah.
The most corrupt CO you can ever think of.
Ever.
But I watched him.
From a regular CO
go all the way to a warden. Mm. And I'm sitting there watching him grow, just grow. Mm. He sat up amongst me with a suit on when I was in a hole. Yeah. And on the phone, in a hole, say, yeah, man, yeah, where you want to go, Scott? He was used to bring us phones in.
Yeah.
Where you want to go, Scott? Folsom or what? You know you can't go. I said, I'll go to Folsom. And I feel good. Right. I feel good seeing him because I knew how corrupt he was. Mm-hmm. Like, man, I know you're going to look out for him. That's how I got to Folsom. Yeah. Right. So I understand the bureaucracy of it all. You know, and so if we don't train ourselves, what's wrong with us being police? What's wrong with us being sheriffs? What's wrong with us being firemen? What's wrong? See, we missing it. Mm-hmm. If you're not in the game, what's wrong with you being that? Mm-hmm. You're not in the game. And see, we teaching them wrong. Mm-hmm. If you're not in the game, man, go be that. So you can come to your community and police your community. See, because we're gonna be more comfortable talking to each other about, hey, man, you need to stop that, man. You know, I'm gonna get at you. I'm gonna get at your cousin, DT. Yeah. Because DT gonna get at you, man. I'm gonna take you. I'm gonna bust you. If you keep on, I'm getting you a shot. You got a bug on you right now. Yeah. I can bust you right now. Mm-hmm. But I'm gonna get at DT, man, because I told you twice. The third time, I'm gonna bust you. And DT gonna tell me, hey, man, he ain't listening, man. Right. He gonna have to.
Instead of having somebody coming through, who's gonna do the opposite?
Yeah, slap us on the head, throw us all against the wall. You know what I mean? So, mm-hmm. You know, going back to my concept, you know, I know I'm long-winded, man, but this is getting me fired up about, you know, our people. What was that? You know, and, you know, I want to move mountains. I don't want to, you know, jump over bricks. So my nonprofit organization is definitely it's going to be subsidiary to find him's motivated to help others. I want to see him, you know, me master that and grow, and I'm going to help him. And then, you know, I'll come behind him. Because we got to lead by example. You know what I mean? I want him to, it's his time to lead right now. It's for me to play the, you know, passenger seat or the back seat. I don't got a problem. I'll be in the trunk. I don't care. You know what I mean? Just as long as we get to the destination.
We all rise
together. I'll be in the truck and say, man, we there yet? Yeah, okay, cool.
We all rising together.
So, you know, that's what I'm about.
Dorothy.org.
Defend is a real true
help. Dorothy.org?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, everybody knows, you can contact me on the Instagram of Motivate to Help Others. With number two, YouTube, and I have a YouTube channel. As I told people before, that Motivate to Help Others began in 2012. We was incarcerated during the Relay for Life Council Walk. And, brought it here to the society, but the foundation of it is to give back to the community through fitness. I'm using fitness as a foundation to give back to the youth, to the adults, to the women, to the men, because so many of us, we need the education to understand fitness, to grow, to keep, to have our mental situation, to have that mental stimulation on point, you know, to eat right, to exercise. And I know that through fitness and just being outside with fitness, it also helped those who deal with so many situations, dealing with stress, dealing with abandonment and things of that nature. So I'm just using Motivate to Help Others to branch off to different, many different facets of life.
I got a few things going on, and one of them, I'm, you know, piggyback off of Fahim, you know, with his exercise program. I still got a nutritious chart that I'm going to incorporate, you know, into his program. You know, and I'm also working on something real big, because it ain't just about us sitting up here. You know, it's also about the victims, you know, that we victimize, you know, throughout our life. And one thing that I want to do is, you know, give back to them and when I mean give back, really give back, because it's a lot of victims out there that don't have any closure. So I'm working on something with a young lady, and we did a few scenes, and it was very emotional, and it's going to be real big, because this is for the whole world to see, because mm-hmm. we can, you know, touch everybody that was a victim, because it's important, because like I said before, it's not just about us. You know, we went to prison, did this, you know, now we come out as better men. But once again, what about the victims? You know, so I do have something coming up real soon. It's going to be real powerful.
Yeah, that's it. Thank you very much, man. Appreciate it.